So good morning, everybody, and thank you for coming. This morning will be a little different than usual. Is there anybody here who is this their first time? So there are some people here. So this is a little different because usually we have a what's called a Dharma talk, which directly relates to the teachings of the Buddha Dharma, meditation, mindfulness, the various teachings about how we heal and transform ourselves. Actually, for many months now, we've been giving talks and practices related to what's called the seven factors of awakening, mindfulness, concentration, joyful, diligent effort, investigation, examination, joy, equanimity, and things like that, letting go. But this past weekend, since Friday, I've been involved with our Florida Community of Mindfulness board. Every couple of years has a weekend retreat. And so the board gathered this weekend, and they're here with us today. And so I want to talk something about the values of our community, which of course I think are our own values. But first, maybe we can introduce, I don't know if everybody even knows who our board is. We should have their pictures up. But basically, the board of our community, they're the ones who are legally, financially kind of responsible for us. The buck stops with them. But they're really the ones who have the big picture in our community. We have many, many people involved in many, many different types of activities at all levels. But the boards are the one. The board is the one that kind of has the overall view of our community and how it's doing and where it's going. It is the ones who are responsible for making sure that everything that we do here. And as we grow and develop, we do more and more, but that everything is congruent with our mission, our vision, and our values. So they caretake that. People serve for 2 years. So maybe we can, why don't we begin? There are a few who have been on the board and are getting off the board. Their service is over. And could you stand up? So this is Brian and Andrew. Andrew has been our president for these past years, and you can remain standing. And then there are those who have who are continuing to serve on the board. Their term isn't up, and they are Robbie. Robbie is a member of ours who lives in near D.C., outside of D.C. Bill Lee, Diane, and there's one more who's from Naples who had to go back last night. And then there are two who are joining the board, and they are Nancy and Kate, as well as myself as teacher, Angie as executive director. We are ex officio on the board, which means we attend all the meetings, but we do not vote because the board, we only serve at the discretion of the board. They can let us go at any moment. So please be seated. So this is the board. So one of the things that we did this weekend was we reviewed our mission statement, things like that. People involved with boards may know about things like mission statements and core values and things like that. And this was something that was developed in a board retreat several years ago when our community was really getting more formal. And a lot of work went into it to articulate it. It was sent out to the Buddha Sangha for feedback. One of the things we did at the board retreat was review them. And I was struck in reviewing them how wonderful they were and how inspiring they are. And they are important because for those of us who are members, they tell us what we're about. And for those who aren't members, they kind of, if they want to know what we're about, it can give you a sense. I think we're going to be handing them out later. and I'm not going to go into them all, but I want to go into a few because especially of the board meeting this weekend. So our vision is, and this is the biggest, our vision is to create a community and eventually a world where principles of loving kindness, generosity, and selflessness result in global peace, environmental sustainability, and the cessation of suffering for all sentient beings. That's the grand vision. That's what we're working toward. And our more particular mission of our community is the Florida Community of Mindfulness offers Buddhist teachings that are relevant to the realities of day-to-day life and lead to personal transformation. FCM provides a variety of educational and practice opportunities to support those who sincerely aspire to cultivate mindfulness, equanimity, compassion, and joyful selfless service to others. So that's more specifically what our mission is, and that we are always working to realize. Now the values, and this is what I sort of want to go into today. And please see that in our vision and our mission was not to turn the world into a universe of Buddhist practitioners. This is not our goal. Our goal is to utilize these wonderful teachings and practices that have been alive within the human family for 2,600 years and have brought so much peace and understanding and tranquility and understanding and compassion, et cetera, et cetera, to so many people and so many cultures. We want to keep this alive in the world because we think it is important. Probably the most important thing. But having said that, it's not as if we have the corner on truth. Luckily, we don't. And luckily, there are many, many types of people of all types, religious, non-religious, who also have a similar kind of vision for their life. So I want to spend a little time on our core values, going into maybe 3 out of the 7. We'll see how much time we have. We'll pass them out, and they are on our website. But without going into them, the core values are awakening, non-denominational Buddhism, community, inclusiveness, mindful living, service, deep sharing, deep listening, and direct transmission. And again, they have explanations of each of those. But I wanted to begin with awakening. And let me just read how this value is expressed. Through the practices of mindfulness, deep understanding, wisdom, and compassion, we grow personally, heal psychologically, and transform our suffering into the flowering of an awakened being. We use Buddhist meditative practices to rediscover eternal truths about reality through direct investigation and experience, rather through blind faith in dogma. So I think this is important that, again, this core value that really unites everyone is this unique value. I don't think you find this in many nonprofits, even spiritual religious ones. That what we value essentially is the capacity of human beings to become enlightened, to wake up, to come out of delusion, to free themselves from ignorance and suffering, and to really flower as human beings. Heal psychologically, it is said, and transform our suffering into the flowering of all the qualities of the awakened mind. And that what we value is not dogma, not catechism, not things like that. What we value is direct experience. That this is a path that everyone can walk, and that is a path that everybody can walk in their life. And it is primarily about investigating, looking into reality, but the reality of each of us. it's not like we got to get a PhD in Buddhism. We need a PhD in our own minds. We need a PhD in what, in the actions of my own body, speech, and mind, cause suffering and unhappiness and dissatisfaction to myself and others, and what is it that produces the opposite? I mean, that's really what it's all about. Right? It's not simply what we call ourselves. It's not the books on our shelves. It's not any of that. It is the way we live our lives. So this central value of that our community and the members of our community value enlightenment, value awakening, again, goes back to that man who became known as the Buddha, Shakyamuni, because Buddhism, what's called Buddhism, the Buddhist teachings, began with his own enlightenment. It did not begin with him reading anything. It did not begin with him hearing Dharma talks. It did not begin with him having discussions. It really began with his own interest, curiosity about what is it within me, in my own actions of body, speech, and mind, that are causing me to suffer, and therefore others to suffer, and to look within his own mind for the relief from that suffering. And in his personal awakening, again, which was a transformative experience, nothing that anyone in here is not capable of, he was able to understand that clearly and resolve it for himself and directly experience his mind, his being, in ways that he never imagined. And he was able to clearly see through all those things within himself that had prevented him from recognizing his essential wholeness, his essential Buddha nature. Okay. A Buddha is just simply the name of somebody who is awake to their true nature. So that's one value. But the two that I really want to focus on, because of the board retreat and what we're involved in, was community and service. And I want to begin. Everybody here knows Thich Nhat Hanh, right? So Thich Nhat Hanh is very much our teacher, somebody we look to, and his body of teaching and practice. For guidance in many ways. And I think most people know that he's 87, and several weeks ago he had a cerebral hemorrhage in France, and is actually, as we speak, as far as we know, in something that may be called a coma or a semi-coma in a hospital in Bordeaux in France under intensive care. And that's just the way it is right now. But interesting enough, he and his communities of Plum Village in France, had been invited. I guess the Vatican was sponsoring recently a conference, a gathering around international slavery, sex trafficking, but slavery that still obviously exists even in our own country, but in many parts of the world. So this was sort of a religious conference on slavery. And I guess people call him Thai, that just means teacher, that refers to Thich Nhat Hanh. He had prepared, I guess, before his cerebral hemorrhage, obviously, his talk, which he was not able to give, obviously, but someone else gave. And I just wanted to read a little bit from it, because I think it really points to our discussion today about community and service. and this is just a part of it. And he said, in this age of globalization, what happens to one of us happens to all. We are all interconnected, and we are all co-responsible. But even with the greatest goodwill, if we are swept away by our daily concerns for material needs or emotional comforts, we will be too busy to realize our common aspiration. Contemplation must go together with action. Without a spiritual practice, we will abandon our dream. And then he goes on to say, I mean, I think that's very clear. He said, in our work to end modern slavery, we must find time. Now, this is where it gets very interesting, and I think that it shows you the uniqueness of Thich Nhat Hanh's vision, because he is very well known. I mean, somebody was saying in the weekend, whenever they read anything by him that is written in the popular press, he's always referred to as what? Thich Nhat Hanh, peace activist. Thich Nhat Hanh, great social activist. I don't think he would call himself that. I think he'd just call himself a Buddhist monk. But so he says, in our work to end modern slavery, we must find time to take care of ourselves. Right? For most of us thinking about that issue, that would not be the first thing we would say. The first thing we're going to do is get together and let's organize ourselves to how we can eradicate modern slavery, right? That's the way we do it. It's interesting, the first thing he says is, we must find time to take care of ourselves and to take care of the present moment. By doing so, we can find some relative peace in our body and mind to continue our work. This is a very powerful injunction to us, isn't it? We need to recognize and embrace our own suffering, our anger, our fear, and despair, so that the energy of compassion can be maintained in our hearts. When we have more clarity in the mind, we will have compassion not only for the victims, but for the traffickers themselves. Again, another significant departure the way most people would see it. Our compassion can help transform them into friends and allies of our cause. So again, I'm sharing with you because I think it is very hard for us. Because in our culture, sloganeering, activism, petitions, demonstrations, voting, you know what I'm saying? All those kinds of things are the way we go about changing things. Okay? And this is not denying that, but this is adding a dimension that is significantly lacking. That somehow, if we are all interconnected, you see, we say these things so easy. We're all interconnected, right? We are all co-responsible. We are all one, right? We are the world. There are songs about that, right? We are the world. Well, if we are the world, then how do you transform the world? Obviously, if we are the world, our own transformation is very much part of, interconnected with, the transformation of the world, right? If we are not the world, then our own personal transformation is just a selfish, narcissistic act, isn't it? But if we are the world, and we want a world that is where the qualities and the values of the world are things like compassion and understanding and recognizing the interconnectedness and taking care of one another, et cetera, then it behooves us to what? To become that person. Right? If we see that war and violence and indifference and injustice are all fueled by anger, indifference, fear, right? Egoism, selfishness. Then if we want to free the world of that, we have to begin where? In ourselves. Because if we can't free it in ourselves, how could we demand it of the world? And that's what we do. Right? We demand it of the world. We are outraged by what goes on in the world, and yet the seeds of what goes on in the world are in us too. Isn't that true? So this understanding of the essentiality of personal transformation is this key piece that Thich Nhat Hanh is offering us, that recognizing, he recently said, it will be very difficult for the human beings of this world to heal the suffering of the planet, which everybody is becoming more and more. He said, how are they going to ever put an end to the suffering of their own planet, to recognize that their planet is suffering and to want to heal and transform it, if they don't even acknowledge that in themselves? If they cannot even see the suffering within themselves and have the capacity and the energy and the interest to heal and transform themselves and those around them, right? So he says, in our work to end slavery, we must learn how to take care of ourselves, to take care of the present moment, so we can continue the work. Many people who do good work in nonprofits, in all kinds of ways, it's sort of like doing this kind of work in all the good things that people do, and in the world of all kinds of activism. We know that one of the things that happens is what? People burn out. You know, burnout is sort of like, it's like normal these days. Right? Well, why do people burn out? Because they don't know how to take care of themselves. They don't see that taking care of themselves and their own inner transformation is directly related to the quote-unquote good work they're doing. And then he says, and this is another very key piece, and sort of relates to what I want to go to today. In order to sustain our work of compassion, right? So please understand, this is about sustaining our work of compassion. Sustaining our capacity to stay present to the suffering of the world. And the suffering of the world is what? Is everywhere. It's on Nebraska Avenue, it's all around the world, it's in our planet, it's in our water, it's in our air, right? It's in our families, it's within ourselves. In order to sustain our compassion, which means our capacity to stay present to suffering and to actively work to alleviate it. In Buddhism, compassion does not just mean empathy. Compassion means being empathic to people who suffer and wanting to remediate it, wanting to change it. It is an active principle. He said, in order to sustain our work of compassion, we all need a spiritual community to support us and protect us. Interesting. In order to sustain our work of compassion in the world, we all need a spiritual community, a spiritual home, a spiritual family to support us and protect us. Protect us from what? From burnout, from indifference, from becoming hard-hearted, from losing our vision, from our own innate laziness and selfishness, self-indulgent, right? We need a community to support us. But then he goes on to say, he says, we need a spiritual community to support us and protect us, a real community, right? Right? So, you know, some of us might go, oh, we're the Florida Community of Mindfulness. We're a spiritual community, right? So I'm glad he says real community. Because that points not to words, not to form, but to meaning. Where there is true brotherhood and sisterhood, compassion and understanding. We should not do this work as lone warriors. The roots of modern slavery run deep, and the causes and conditions, the networks and structures supporting it are complex. That is why we need to build a community that can continue this work to protect human life, not just until 2020. And perhaps, I'm just guessing that perhaps the aim of this conference was to eradicate slavery by 2020, I'm just guessing. Not just to protect human life until 2020, but long into the future. Right. And I think spiritual work is big picture work. It is long-term work. It's not driven by crisis, because crises are just endless. You know, there are many people in their own personal life are crisis-driven, and they live crisis to crisis, right? And there are many people who outwardly, in terms of responding to the world, endless and crisis after crisis after crisis after crisis. Anybody who is involved in anything will find in their inbox on a daily basis an endless tug about a crisis that's going on today. Close hand and everywhere and anywhere in the world. At some point, we need to take a big picture and say, yeah, this is the way things are. But what is the source of that? See, in Buddhism, the tool that we talked about yesterday, the awakened tool, is not anything other than looking deeply into, investigating deeply the nature of reality. And the nature of reality is understanding what is causing this. Whether we are looking deeply into our own suffering, not just responding to it, not just acting out from it, but looking, turning around and looking deeply into it so we really understand what's causing it so we can liberate ourselves really and not just go day by day, case to case. You know, many people practice the practice of letting go. Right? Endless. Every day they grab on and every day they let go. Right? And they get up the next day, grab on and let go. That is a weak practice. We want to get down to see what's the cause. What's the cause of my grasping? What is the cause of my attachments? Right? Why do I always grab on? Once I figure out why I'm grabbing on and I stop doing that, I won't have to be endlessly practicing letting go. Is that clear? So this is in the same way that we want to look deeply into our own life so we understand it, so we can act wisely, intelligently, skillfully, competently in our own life. We must look deeply into these issues. What's the cause of these issues? Why are they endless? Right? You know, in our own century, the last century too. But remember we learned about this in high school. Remember there was a war to end all wars? Does everybody remember that? The war to end all wars. Well, why didn't the war to end all wars end all wars? And why has every war since then not ended all wars? We have to look deeply into these things. So when we act, we're not just going from crisis to crisis, war to war, situation to situation, but we see the bigger picture, and we see the bigger picture because we've looked deeply into it. So that is why he says the roots of modern slavery run deep. And when you go deep into them, you will find many aspects of things that have seemed to have nothing to do with slavery, but are supporting slavery. A Buddhist community. This is another quote from Thich Nhat Hanh in his book, Friends on the Path, Living Spiritual Communities. He says, a sangha, and sangha is the word in Buddhist tradition, it's a Sanskrit word that usually relates to, it's a label for the Buddhist community, okay? But this is the way he defines it. He says, a sangha is a community of friends practicing the Dharma, which are the teachings of the Buddha, together in order to bring about and maintain awareness. The essence of a sangha is awareness, understanding, acceptance, harmony, and love. Is that clear? We can call ourselves a sangha, but if the individuals in the sangha and collectively how we relate to one another are not characterized by awareness, understanding, acceptance, harmony, and love, then we are not a sangha. When you do not see these in a community, it is not a true sangha, and you should have the courage to say so. But when you find these elements are present in a community, you know that you have the happiness and fortune of being in a real sangha. Right? This community, this Florida Community of Mindfulness, will not become a real sangha just by saying we are, calling ourselves such, right? Joining, paying our dues, going to retreats, being involved in intensives, attending meditation, listening to Dharma talks, doing all our study and daily meditation. That will not create. Those are the engines, right? Those are the engines that give us the possibility of becoming human beings who have that capacity because they have been awakened within ourselves. The practices, the study, are about awakening these qualities. Right? It is not about how many Buddhist books we've read. It's not about that I know the seven of this, the nine of that. It's not how many retreats I've been to. It's not about how many different practices I do. It's not about any of that. Right? It's about do I and my community live in awareness? Awareness means what? That we are aware, we are present, our eyes are open, we see, we hear, we smell, and we touch reality. We are aware of it. The opposite of awareness is to be lost in our thoughts. When we are lost in our thoughts about reality, people, situations, ourselves, we are not in reality. We are not living in awareness. We are living in what in Buddhism is called delusion. Who creates delusion? We do. How do we do it? Because we think all our distorted thinking about a reality is reality. We are not living in awareness. When we live in the awareness, we have the capacity of understanding how things really are. And then from that will come a deep acceptance of the world, of people, of situations, a deep natural compassion. We will live in harmony with the way things are, and we will have the capacity of love. When you do not see these, it is not a true sangha, and you should have the courage to say so. In a real community, we should have the courage to say so. Who should we say it to? First of all, we should say it to ourselves. Right? We should have the courage to name our own delusion. We should have the courage to acknowledge when we are out of sync with these values. Right? The mirror should primarily be on ourselves. And we should have the courage and the fortitude to reflect our own actions of body, speech, and mind in the mirror of these truths. Am I living in awareness? Am I really cultivating understanding Right. Understanding of myself, my own thoughts, my own reactions, and also trying to understand those around me. Understanding means I'm willing to enter their world, understand the causes and conditions that have created them, so I am not judging them. I do not want them to be different than they are. I can understand how they are, the way they are, and then from understanding and love and compassion, I can work with them to heal and transform. It's a very different place than a place of judgment. So we should have the courage to say to ourselves first that I am not living. My mind is not in harmony with the values and the truths of this community that I have entered, this path that I am walking. Right? But then we should have the courage to say it to other people in the community when we perceive that our brothers and sisters, our friends, are not living according to the truths that our community is upholding. And this takes what? Skill. We're not talking around going around blasting each other. We're not talking about a 70s kind of encounter group. We're not talking about, you know, the tough love stuff. But we're talking about when we see that either individuals within our community or our community as a whole is not acting, speaking from a place of understanding and compassion and love and harmony, but actually from another place, we have an obligation to be a mirror not just to ourselves, but to others. It does take courage. It does take skillfulness. It does take understanding, compassion, and clarity. But we have to do this because it is our job within a community to maintain the integrity of the community. Or else we become a shell. We become hypocrites, phonies, right? But he says again, when you find these elements are present in a community, you know that you have the happiness and fortune of being in a real sangha. My hope is that this community will be a real sangha, a real community. So coming back to our core values, in our core value, it is written community. This is one of our core values. And we write, having the support and personal connection with the Sangha community of spiritual friends is a key element of our Buddhist practice. We seek to live our path with the support of a harmonious practice community. Sangha building is, in itself, a meaningful and deep practice which embodies interconnection instead of separateness. We as Americans, we are very individualistic, aren't we? We value independence, don't we? Many people do not like to be dependent on others. Like, as my grandson says, I can do it myself. Actually, he doesn't say it that way. He means that. He actually says, because he doesn't have all his pronouns correct, he will say, do it yourself, when he means himself. So it's a little confusing, but I can do it myself. That's sort of, you know, they start that at 2 years old and we continue all the way up. Again, it's not that it's not good as an individual to have abilities and competencies and a sense of confidence in your own abilities. That's good. But when that becomes more than just a healthy attribute of a healthy human being, but becomes a cause, and our individuality becomes a cause, then we create a sense of separation from. We lose our connection to the whole. And in our separate and disconnection, we often feel alone. We feel lonely. We feel different then. We feel outside of, not part of. And that is, I think, a great emotional suffering that is present in our society, not only because of our strong tradition of individualism, but because that is enculturated in so many of the values of our society these days. And that our sense of connection, our sense of interdependence, our sense of being responsible for each other, right? So many in our society say, what? You know, I'm responsible for me, you take responsibility for yourself. And whether that is in families, in relationships, in societies, among different groups and all that, is that sense of disconnection. I am not responsible for you. And yet we are responsible for each other, and we are affected by the actions of each other. And that works it out, whether it's in the smallest of a relationship of two people, right up through society. That is why in Buddhism we have a vision of not just personal liberation, but for liberation of the world. Because as individuals we will never be free. As long as people are not free, we will never be happy. As long as the world has unhappy people, unhappy people do unhappy things, and we cannot eradicate the unhappy things that people, unhappy people do by killing them and locking them up. Ultimately, we can only do it by entering into a process of healing and transformation with them, which begins with understanding. So, a key value of our community is community. And we see the cultivation of community as a practice. See, when we used to be a community that rented our own space, we had a very lovely community. Right? We came together once a week. For a few hours, we sat down next to each other, we greeted each other, we talked nicely afterwards, and then we went our own separate ways. It was quite lovely. But much too easy. When you have a facility like you have, here, when you have board meetings, when you have, when you grow, and you have people with different opinions, different ideas about how things should be done or not done. When you have, when you have human beings interacting together, you know what they do. Right? They just love to create trouble. They're always up to some mischief. Somebody's not doing something right, or somebody said something they shouldn't have said, or we get hurt, we get bothered, we get frustrated. I mean, that's just right. We can't go a day without doing that stuff. So I think that is, I am very happy that as our community has grown and we've taken on more responsibility, that we sometimes rub up against each other. And all the garbage that we carry around begins to come out here. Again, if we are a healthy community, we have the capacity of being present to that in our awareness, and we have the tools to transform that, to transform the reactions within ourselves, and also to engage in a meaningful way with those who we see are suffering, or maybe the cause of our perception that they are causing us to suffer. So community becomes a practice, the same way a family is a practice. I did a workshop, I think, for people about a year or two ago, where it was entitled "Relationship as a Path of Practice." Right? Many people see relationship as what? Well, an obstacle of practice. Many people said, "Oh, if I only had a better relationship, my practice would be so much deeper." Right? If I could just change this relationship, change this, change that, these are all obstacles to my practice. I could be such a developed human being if it wasn't for this person in my life. Right? No. This person in our life is giving us the opportunity to become a real human being. Right? So that's why I call that relationship as a path to awakening. Family as a path to awakening. Sangha, community, as a path to awakening. When we see that it is in these types of relationships and the obstacles that we perceive, and we see them as no longer obstacles, but as actually the very sources of our transformation, we will change. I was going to talk about service and selfless service, but I don't think I have time to do justice to it, since we have, I think we have in about 10, 12 minutes, we have children coming in here. They're having a family program today. Any quick comments or questions about what was said so far? Yes.
When you're talking about understanding and compassion for others, meaning that step out to I'm not sure which person, but he said nothing human is alien to me, and it stuck with me for a while, because thinking about seeing we separate ourselves from those people who are doing wrong, something we don't agree with.
Yeah.
And with that quote kind of ringing true to you, thinking about how, nothing that they do is foreign to you. We've
right.
felt that anger before. Maybe not necessarily in that situation, but we felt it.
Yes.
And understanding and having that compassion through that.
Right, so just relating the meaningfulness of a quote, nothing human is alien to me, and how meaningful that is. Again, as you saw, he'd made a statement going to a conference to outlaw human trafficking. He said, we have to have love and understanding, compassion for the traffickers. We very easily have compassion for the victims. But the problem will only cease when we have understanding and compassion of the traffickers. But the traffickers are what? They themselves, probably many of them, were victims of trafficking or have their own issues. And this world will only be transformed when we start turning the world into good people and bad people. Because good people and bad people are always changing, right? Right? Not too many years ago, Germans and Japanese were the bad people. Now they're the good people. I mean, what happened? And now other people who were the good people are now the bad people. And if you read human history, you'll see that's just what goes on. At some point, we have to look deeply, right? And get beyond the labels of friend and enemy and victim and perpetrators, and see perpetrators when they were young were often victims. Where do perpetrators come from? What are the conditions that create perpetrators, traffickers? It's only when we look deeply that we will see the solution. And we can only do that if we're willing to embrace the humanity of everyone. As long as we think these people have humanity and these people don't have humanity, it'll just continue on. Well, thank you. So why don't we stop now? And in relationship to community, I want to call up Sam. Sam, would you come up here? This is, for those of you who don't know Sam, this is Sam Warlick. Just come sit here, Sam. I want to introduce everybody to Sam. And you know we are having at 12:30. You know, right after this at 12, there'll be a report back to the board, to the community, and people who are members and non-members are welcome to stay to really just talk generally about the goals that were set for our community for the next 3 years and 18 months and 3 years. And then after that at 12:30, there will be a pizza party honoring Sam, who does enjoy a good pizza.
Vegetarian pizza.
A vegetarian pizza, Peter. But the reason we are honoring Sam today is because Sam has been integral, essential reason that all this is here. For those of you who remember several years ago when we first purchased this church, this was a, and I'm just speaking nicely now to call it a rundown church. This was not a rundown church. This was a vastly deteriorated church that had basically been neglected for financial reasons and other things for years and years and years and years. It was a disaster. And it was a disaster. Because it was a disaster, we could afford to buy it. but Sam was a student of mine who I kind of picked up many years ago. And I go up every year to North Carolina to do a retreat at the Southern Dharma Retreat Center. Many, many years ago when I first started there, I used to do retreats on Buddhism and psychotherapy for mental health professionals. And that's where Sam and Marilyn, we first encountered each other. We stayed connected. Sam was actually practicing in another tradition then and different teachers. But over time, we sort of stuck with each other. And eventually, Sam and Marilyn, his good wife, joined our community, but lived in North Carolina, Salisbury, North Carolina. Sam retired from a long career in the VA and many other things he's done. And the thing is, when we purchased this place and we had this disaster on our hands, and we didn't have the slightest idea what to do other than a vision, Sam came. And Sam was probably the one person in our community who had all the requisite skills that this place needed to transform it. And Sam has been wonderful. Sam has showed up day after day after day. The last year has certainly been easy for him. The first year, I thought it was going to kill him. It came close. I kept having to say, Sam, stop working so hard. And it was hard work, and Sam is not a young man. He acts as if he's a young man. He tried to work as if he was a young man, but he was not a young man. And so there was a lot of physical suffering over these past years for him. But there was no job too dirty, too menial, that Sam ever would not do. He was an inspiration to all of us. Again, this place is what it is because of Sam's energy, but because of his selflessness. I mean, he just, when he moved down here, it was no conditions. He said, well, I'll move down if you get this ready for me and that ready for me. I want this kind of place and this kind of situation and this kind of reimbursement. Sam didn't say anything. He said, Fred, you tell me when you close, I'll be there the next day. And it was like that. Eventually, his wife moved down to join him, and they now reside close by. But Sam is really, we can talk about selfless service. We can talk about the Bodhisattva path. We can talk about it on and on. But Sam has really shown us the way. And for that, we are deeply appreciative. And it is also, I think, just personally, Sam, you know, Sam over this course of 2 years bumped up against Sam. Sometimes he bumped up to it, he just kind of rubbed him up against himself. Sometimes he really got a 2x4 across the head, bumping up to himself. And the wonderful thing about Sam, whenever his teacher took him aside, Sam always listened. And Sam was willing to face his own darkness, his own long-term. Sam has a wonderful story. History, very different than many of us, but Sam was always willing to face his demons, his history, the things from his ancestors that still dwelled within him, and really has used these 2 years of hard work to transform himself as well. The reason we're having this today is at the end of December, Sam is officially because pretty much everything is completed, kind of ending his service here. He still is very much part of our community. We certainly will rely on him in many ways, but his showing up on a regular basis is coming to an end. And so we want to take this opportunity to bow deeply to him. And on behalf of the board of directors and behalf of the Sangha, I want to present this little box to you that may have something for you. And does Alex, we have about 2 minutes. Where's Alex? Can you, because the kids will be in here in 2 minutes. But this Alex has kind of been the one in our community who's worked very closest with Sam over these past 2 years.
Sam and I go back about 3.5 years. He rolled up in his truck that he put all his possessions in. About 2.5 years ago, on August 2nd of 2012, because we had executed our contract and took possession of this as-is church on August 2nd of 2012.
So, Alex, we're just talking to this, just so.
Okay, can everyone hear me?
Well, it's also for the live stream.
Okay. So, again, Sam came on August 2nd, 2012. We took possession of this as-is building 2012, and Sam, true to his word, came to work. And he's worked full-time for 2.5 years, selflessly. To me, Sam embodies the Bodhisattva ideal of selfless service. One anecdote I want to share with you, because I know the time is short, but Sam has developed this legend about him in terms of what he can do. And the reason I want to share this with you is you can look up and see these tie rods up in the ceiling. And I've had a few people come up to me and say, Sam, they've said, when is Sam going to take these tie rods down that he put up? Because they're not very pretty. And they don't realize that these were put up in 1952. And Sam doesn't do all of that. He's not restructured the building. He's renovated it, but he hasn't built it. But the legend is that Sam has built this building. This is the church that Sam built. So we are deeply appreciative. This Sam is coming from the heart of the Sangha. It is a journal of people who have made entries to express their gratitude and the wonderful privilege that they have of knowing you and all the lives that you've touched in the Sangha. So thank you.
Thank you.